Very good morning and hearty welcome to each one of you, my dear professional friends, for third day workshop on transfer pricing. In fact, today is the last day of the workshop, and in the last 2 days we have understood about basics of transfer pricing, comparables, TP methodologies, TP documentation, audit, assessment and proceedings before GRP. Today, just to brief the overview of session, first session will be on the topic Safe Harbor, Section 92 CB, Read with Rules. Second session will be on Advanced Pricing Agreement, Section 92 CC and Section 92 CD, along with relevant rules. Thus, both the sessions will be handled by CA Ganesh Krishnamurthy, CA Deepak Raikar, and CA Sonal Dangi. In the afternoon session, we have third session on the topic Secondary Adjustment and Thin Capitalization. Fourth session will be on CBCR and Master File. This session will be handled by CA Narendra Jain. Now I request CA Saurabh to kindly escort our today's speakers onto the dais. I also request CA Saurabh to kindly welcome our speakers by presenting the floral bouquet. Big round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, sir. To briefly introduce about our today's speakers, C. Ganesh Krishnamurthy is a director with Deloitte's India Transfer Pricing Practice and has over 13 years of experience in the areas of international tax and transfer pricing. He has authored various articles in leading tax publications and was invited by the Inland Revenue Department of Sri Lanka in 2015 to present to them on best practices in relation to transfer pricing policy administration. Mr. Ganesh is a commerce graduate and is a member of Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. With this brief introduction, I welcome you for today's session, sir. To briefly introduce about CA Deepak Raikar, Mr. Deepak is a senior manager with Deloitte's transfer pricing practice in Bangalore. He has over 9 years of consulting experience in transfer pricing. He has assisted the MNCs and the Indian companies in the transfer pricing litigation, planning and transaction structuring, mutual agreement proceedings and advanced pricing agreement proceedings. Mr. Deepak is commerce graduate and is a member of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. With this brief introduction, I welcome you once again for today's session, sir. CA Sonal Dangi, she is a deputy manager with the transfer pricing practice at Deloitte India and has 3 years of experience in assisting global MNCs on advanced pricing agreements, safe harbor, transfer pricing documentation, audits and litigation. She has assisted companies in end-to-end process of advanced pricing agreements, that is filing stage to signing of the agreement. She has recently assisted Deloitte partner and manager in writing an article on recent Ahmedabad ruling on Vodafone published in the TPI and international publication on transfer pricing. With this very brief introduction, I welcome you for today's seminar. Over to you, sir.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. The next couple of hours, we'll be talking about a very important framework within the Indian tax legislation, which is to do with the safe harbors and advanced pricing agreements. As you've been discussing over the past few days, you know, the basics of transfer pricing and how and why transfer pricing as a legislation has come into India. One of the very common features of this legislation, and it's not something unique to India, it's across the world, is the transfer pricing legislation is based on a fundamental principle, something called arm's length, right? And that term itself is a very complicated term, because arm's length is very subjective. It is subjective to the facts of a business, it's subjective to a transaction under scrutiny, it is subject to, you know, the activities undertaken by a business. So I'm sure that over the past couple of days, you would have had some introduction into how do you do an analysis of transfer pricing, right? So having crossed that bridge of understanding what goes into a transfer pricing analysis, assuming that you know taxpayers have done that analysis, assuming that they have fixed a transfer price, yeah, the next step that comes in is how do you defend it? How do you address the requirements of the Indian Tax Administration? So when transfer pricing came into picture way back in 2001, India had made its mark in the world map by having this law in place, because many countries in the world realized that global trade is a reality. Globalization is the way forward. And globalization means that there will be cross-border transactions. There will be exchange of, goods, services, financial transactions, arrangements across the world between various entities. And it's a fact that close to 90% of world trade happens within or between group companies, right? And that makes it challenging. That makes transfer pricing interesting, because you are hypothesizing an arrangement which a third party would enter into, and therefore you are trying to determine an arm's length price. And therefore, when the legislation came way back in 2001, many practitioners, including some of us, were trying to figure out how do you document transfer prices, how do you defend transfer prices. And that's why you saw, for example, that in the beginning, 2001 to 2005, everyone was trying to find their way around what should we do? What is the documentation? So when we talk about Rule 10D, 92D of the Income Tax Act, where we Rule 10D of the rules, there was a list of information that had to be maintained. So the first few years saw compliance. Every taxpayer was complying with, okay, let's tick the box. Have we maintained this information? Have we prepared this certificate? So all of it. So it was more of compliance. Then the tax administration started doing the audits, which is from 2005 to 2008, you saw a lot of notices going to the taxpayer saying, furnish the documentation that you have maintained. Furnish the information on transactions. And that's when even the tax administration was trying to get up to speed on, okay, how do we do an audit? What do we look at when a taxpayer gives a documentation? What in that documentation helps me confirm the arm's length price, right? And therefore, I would say the first 10 years literally was a learning curve for both the taxpayer and the tax administration. It was a learning curve which was very important, but it also created a lot of difficulties. Difficulties because each one had their own view. And when we talk about global multinationals, they tend to prefer a kind of consistent approach across various countries. So if a company, for example, manufactures a product in China and sells it to its counterparty in the US, for example, although today China and US are not on talking terms, but let's take that as an example. The price or the pricing policy that the Chinese company uses to sell the products to its group company in the US, the Chinese company would want to follow that same policy for exports to any other country as well, right? So they would like to follow a consistent policy. The price may be different. The policy would be similar. There's a difference. The policy can be, say, X works plus or net margin or some kind of a third-party comparable price or cost of manufacturing plus a load-up of the cost. So it can be various policies, but the price can be different because it depends on which country you are shipping to, what are the kind of activities. So they would like to follow a consistent policy. Now, with that in mind, most companies documented their policy in India and set it up in the same manner. However, when the authorities looked at it, when the tax administration looked at it from India's standpoint, they said this is not acceptable because we have a different set of data for third parties, we have some databases from where we do our comparability analysis, and therefore that data is not supported. So you saw, for example, 2005 to 2008, in fact to 2010 or 11, a spate of transfer pricing audits and litigation. That's what prompted the lawmakers to come to the table and say, okay, how do we avoid, help taxpayers avoid such disputes? In fact, it's a very funny thing that came up. If you see any international publication at that point of time, in that era, 70 to 80% of a publication was dominated by India, because most of the rulings, most of the publication had pages of what rulings have come from the courts. Now that's great literature to read, but that doesn't make us proud, right? Because it becomes difficult then to explain to a multinational why they should invest in India. So that created a lot of flutter, that created a lot of confusion, and that's why you saw, for example, from 2009 onwards, initiatives were taken to help taxpayers avoid such disputes. So can we give them some kind of, can the tax administration give some kind of guidance to say, okay, if you do this, you are safe. So you saw safe harbors and APAs coming in, and my colleagues will talk about how and what are these concepts, and we'll go into a lot of detail. I would encourage you to, please ask as many questions. It's meant to be interactive. And today, what we are seeing today is again a changed world where we are moving towards a global reporting. A global reporting where authorities across the world are going to share information between them. And that's where we saw a global tax revolution in the form of base erosion and profit shifting. An upward trend in a graph nowadays is always a good trend. It shows that we are growing. But this graph is a bit of a misnomer, because this doesn't help. It shows that our litigations have always grown. Yeah? So the good thing to realize, and I just ask, pause for a few seconds for you to just look at the statistics. If you see anything which is interesting from this trend. Any thoughts, any observations on this statistic?
Why 2013 is highest and then is again coming down?
Because advanced pricing agreement, and when you got safe harbor rules, slowly started dropping.
Good question, sir. I'll respond to that, but I want some, this is very interesting. You observed it correctly. Any other thoughts? Any other observations?
The understanding between multinationals to arrive at a common platform that has prompted several of these litigations or differences to be evened out. So there is a perceptible reduction in disputable clauses and agreements. And differences in price.
Good. Another observation is that the number of adjustment cases are increasing, but the in terms of value is decreasing.
Yes. Okay. Good. Good observation. Anything else?
And you increase it because of the safe harbor rules.
Okay.
I guess this also shows the learning curve of the officers, because, like you said, between 2005 to 2008. Is when they understood, is this the way to document, how do we document an audit, how do we see that, how do we perform the audit? So they performed it better, and that's how the cases rose. And then they understood what exactly to do it.
Interesting. So very good observations. Now, yeah, please.
If you see, if you divide the amount of adjustment divided by the number of cases, the case, the adjustment per case is reducing. It's in a decreasing trend. So they, it gives an idea of the businesses are getting streamlined with the TP laws and all that.
Very good. Very good observations. And I really encourage you to think about it more actively. Very good. Couple of the things that happened, and you alluded to very good points on learning curve, on the adjustment per case, and how is it growing. So I would break this into two or three phases. The first phase is where literally the tax administration did not know what to ask for. So they were just issuing notices to everyone saying that please give information. So the first few years, if you see, the number of cases which were subject to an assessment were very low because they didn't know what to ask for. So they targeted specific sectors or specific type of taxpayers and issued notices. So the number of notices were also less. Adjustment correspondingly was also less because they didn't know how to make an adjustment. Right? It's a new law, right? So they are evolving the system. And then you move to a mid-phase where you saw the number of notices were increasing. The adjustments were also significant. So if I look at, say, 2011-12, and you see 2012-13, I would see, so the number of cases didn't increase, but the adjustment increased. And that was because of a few cases where the tax administration went on doing a high-pitched assessment, significantly high-pitched assessment. You heard of a lot of cases like Vodafone and Shell, etc. There was a thought process of saying that there are certain transactions which should be subject to transfer pricing law, but the taxpayer disagreed. And that resulted in a lot of these adjustments. Are these real adjustments or notional adjustments? That is disputed. Because a lot of such cases, when they go up to courts, have been reversed as well. So what we have shown here is the adjustment made by the officer, okay, which has gone to higher courts. And therefore, the first phase, it was more of understanding, learning, and a target-driven approach. So the tax administration also had their own targets to achieve, right? So therefore, they made adjustments. That was also part of the story. Subsequently, they realized very quickly that it is not an efficient approach. Like any other corporate, you're using your resources to study taxpayers and make an income adjustment to collect taxes. That is the objective, right? The end objective is they have to collect taxes which are not disputed. If after all these disputes, if they are losing money and paying back taxpayers with interest, what's the point in doing the dispute? So they realized very quickly that we have to be efficient here. So the number of cases also started reducing. Adjustments were more or less there, but the number of cases, they said, we look at select cases. We go focused on taxpayers who have actually manipulated or avoided taxes. So the chapter 10 on transfer pricing is on avoidance of taxes, right? And therefore they went very focused on that. Very valid points, APAs, etc. came in, so that could have also resulted in lesser adjustments. But during this era, there were very few APAs which were concluded. Taxpayers were into an APA. So the effect of an APA had not yet factored in, right? So that's something to bear in mind. So this created the backdrop or the need for having dispute avoidance or dispute resolution frameworks. Dispute avoidance is where APA and safe harbor comes in. Because you want to avoid any disputes, you want to have an upfront settlement. Like in the US, you can sit across the table and agree with the IRS to say that, you know, we agree that this will be the price and we are willing to deposit this taxes. That is not a framework that's available in India today. So APA and Safe Harbor gives a framework for dispute avoidance, and my colleagues will talk about these frameworks. I would request you to note down your questions at any point and please raise it. Let's make it interactive. And hand it over to my colleague Deepak, who will take you through the Safe Harbor provisions.
Good morning, friends, and thank you, Ganesh, for providing a detailed overview and setting the stage for discussion on safe harbor and APA. To begin with, as Ganesh mentioned, TP, arm's length price, these were slightly complicated words. So always, I think you being some of the great experience in the litigation, always, you will be already aware PTP is one of the area with lot of litigation and that stat provides it. So safe harbor is one of the options which is provided to mitigate these litigations. So for a taxpayer, rather than following a regular compliance, going to a transfer pricing officer, a CIT appeal, is there alternate ways available? So one of the way which I want to discuss today is on a safe harbor. Is any of you have at least a brief idea about safe harbor, what it may be? I will go into it. If anybody want to just have a quick guess on this.
They have specified certain percentages of cost plus, basically it's gain and cost plus. They have specified certain percentages industry wise. Say for example, if it's for IT and IT years, maybe not development, it is 20, it was 20% and later it was reduced to 17%. If it was development, it was 30% I guess. So various percentages
yes.
They have specified.
Absolutely right. So as
safe harbor evolved around the thinking that you can envisage situations which can be avoided provided you go into an agreement and look at things before they happen so that the business can have a reasonable amount of assurance that they will not face any uncertainty regarding the tax payments.
Absolutely, sir. To summarize, safe harbor is a simplified procedures. To put it, if a eligible taxpayer, I'll come to what is eligible taxpayer in some point of time when I go into details. If the taxpayer follows certain prescribed conditions, if prescribed, if he want to opt those conditions, he can choose these safe harbor provisions. The objective is simplify compliances. The second objective is the tax administration, which were focusing on low pitch issues, which were not really generating them a good amount of revenue, to concentrate their resources in a more complex cases so that the tax administration objective has been achieved. So these were the two primary objectives where this safe harbor provisions came into prominence. And the other important fact we need to understand, so it is not a universally applicable principle. The laws, whatever the criteria prescribed, are very clear. Only the eligible taxpayer can opt for it, and the focus will be on the small and medium enterprises. Once we go into the detail, you will observe that these provisions were focused more on a smaller scale taxpayers primarily. The other important aspect we should be aware is this is an optional for the taxpayer. Rules are there. If some taxpayer want to not to get covered under this, can always choose not to opt for this. This is one of the criteria is. So I'll just move into the this. So even the safe harbor guidelines were prescribed under OECD, and India also implemented few of the provisions which were relating to safe harbors. So what were the pros and cons of safe harbor? For a taxpayer point of view, once he opt for this provision, there will be a reduction in compliance cost. He can mitigate the litigation. This will be the primary positives you can take away from the safe harbor. And it provides a certainty. I'll just take an example so that you can get a perspective. Being in a Bangalore, one of the industry we generally come across is software development and IT enabled services. Safe harbor says ki, safe harbor provision says if you go with the prescribed percentage, suppose in a software cases the markup which is proposed is cost plus 17% under safe harbor. If the taxpayer is agreeable to that number, he can go with the cost plus 17%. And from an tax administrative point of view, the TPO need to accept those rates. There will not be any litigations. There is no scrutiny will be there on the pricing front, provided the activities were covered under required framework. So by doing this, there will be a reduction in the litigation cost. And one of the objectives, as Ganesh mentioned, is on foreign direct investment. If you see the kind of litigations India, the MNCs were facing in India is significant. This was given a bad publicity to India during those point of time. So they wanted to avoid this. They wanted to invite additional investment. So Safe Harbor provided that opportunity to the government to minimize this litigation. So probably these were the problems what we can see under Safe Harbor. What will be the, as any policy comes up with, once you see a positive side, there will be always the negative aspect will be involved into this. One of the critical points we need to understand is this Safe Harbor rate, whatever we are explaining, are not arm's length price. Because when I think from a last 2 days session, you would have come across how we need to determine arm's length price, we need to undertake a detailed economic analysis. But these Safe Harbor rate, whatever prescribed, are not arm's length price. Based on our internal analysis, the government has prescribed this rate. If you are able to agree to this, it is fine. The second important aspect from a Safe Harbor will be generally higher than a standard arm's length price. If you take a software as an example, generally what we see, the margin which were in the range of 12 to 15% can be generally be an arm's length price for a low-end software services, but the rate prescribed are 17%. The objective is simple. If the taxpayer want to minimize his litigation, naturally government wants some premium than a routine margin. So this is one of the aspects we should be aware of. The third point which slightly what I say is additional burdensome for a taxpayer is, despite opting for a Safe Harbor, he need to continue with his TP documentation. I wonder, okay, once you are opting for a Safe Harbor and there is no litigation will be involved, why a taxpayer need to maintain a TP documentation? Right, who is going to look into this documentation? So some of the procedures were strange, but we need to live with it. This is one of the, what I can say, the demerits of the Safe Harbor rules which were present as on date. From a taxpayer point of view, the other area you need to be aware is, once you opt for a Safe Harbor, you need to provide the details in terms of what are your activity to a, broadly to the tax authority. If the officer concludes this activity is not covered under Safe Harbor, so obviously there is an element of information is already available with the officer. So there is a possibility that there will be increased scrutiny for that particular case. Whenever it is covered under regular tax assessment procedure, the first question the officer likely to ask is, you opted for a Safe Harbor, what is the reason it got rejected? Are you doing some complex activity? So that kind of line of thinking, it may see the officer may start under regular litigation. So these were the broad the positives along with its flip side of existing Safe Harbor provisions. If you want to have any specific questions, you can ask me so that we can clear at this point of time. Any questions on the overview, the positives or demerits, any thoughts, welcome.
What for they will, a client has to maintain that TP documentation once the Safe Harbor condition is given by the authority? What is the purpose?
So this is what I wanted to highlight, sir. There is no tangible purpose it is getting served at this point of time. If you look at the global guidance on OECD, they prescribe, their guidance is very clear. Once there is a safe harbor provision is opted by your taxpayer, there should not be any compliance burden on a taxpayer. But in India, this has been clearly provided under the Act. Yes, you can opt for a safe harbor, but you need to continue with the TP documentation and even the TP certification, which is form 3CB, you need to file.
For safe harbor, they must be needing some money to be deposited something.
Else. Yes, sir.
So this is one cost. Another cost is maintaining these documents. So for small traders and small parties, it's a double cost.
Yes, sir. On a beginning you may feel that, but the kind of litigation cost involved under a regular is very significant. If you look at once you need to maintain your compliance documentation, then the cost will be there at the time of your assessment. You need to go to a CIT. And based on the past trend, you can see 10 out of 7 cases are resulting in a TP adjustment. So then you need to go to a CIT office, then ITAT, then High Court. It's never ending. Yes, there is at the initial stage you will be continue having this compliance cost, but it's better than going with a never ending litigation.
If you're opting for the safe harbor, should we have to file any form upfront during the coming act?
There is a form required at the time of filing tax return.
I think CFA.
Yes. I will be covering that in the later part of the section under procedure for filing safe harbor. I will come to that.
One question. Generally, the safe harbor rates are higher than the AOP. What is the trend now? The companies are opting for that? Because multinational entities, you said they will be following a prescribed policy for all the other companies. So if in India it is higher, so how they are doing?
I think very good question. I'll just brief you how the safe harbor panned out in India. See, this safe harbor provisions in the Act came out in 2009, wherein the government through Finance Act 2009 empowered CBDT to introduce safe harbor rules, and the actual rules, you believe it or not, the actual rules for safe harbor came in 2013, almost 4 years after introduction of safe harbor under Act. So I can say ki the safe harbor rules were the first set of safe harbor rules came in 2013, then those rules were revised in the 2017. If you look at the rate which were prescribed in 2013, was significantly high. The minimum rate start with cost plus 20%. 22 and a few of the high end, contract R&D, what is covered under safe harbor, was 30%. On the practical front, if you see in a location like Bangalore with so many cost plus entities, hardly maybe single digit filings.
Is it right, Ganesh?
Lot of them, single and perhaps the lower double digits.
Okay. So the it received a low cost response from taxpayer. There is nobody interested in even thinking about safe harbor rules. Government realized this aspect, ki the rate which were in the range of 20 were realistically nobody is going to accept. Even somebody want to accept, this create a problem on the other side of the transaction, the country wherein. So they rationalize it. If you look at the present rates, those were very, I will not say they are same with the ELP rates or the rate which you can get under APA scheme, but they are very much rationalized. They start with 17% and 18%. Probably significant portion of the activity will get covered under 17% to 18%. When I look at from a Bangalore market perspective. Yes?
I think just to add to that, in terms of whether the safe harbor rates as they exist today are finding are attractive to taxpayers, the answer is a mixed bag, because yes, they are lower than the earlier rates, but the advice to taxpayers should be based on their global policy. Because what you wouldn't want is, for example, if as Deepak highlighted, these are not arm's length rates. These are a settled rate, right? So you agree. But this can have a repercussion in other countries in which the company has similar operations, where they follow a different policy. And there the tax administration there may ask a question to that taxpayer that if you're following a cost plus 17% in India for India purposes, why should it be any lower in that country? So the discussion with taxpayers has to be in that context of not saying that, okay, buy peace with the tax administration, offer cost for 17%, but whether it makes sense for you in other parts of the world. So if they don't have any similar operations in other parts of the world, and you have a situation in India where we want the business to focus on the business and not in the courts, you would probably advise them on safe harbor. So the advice should be based on what is their holistic operations, what do they do in other parts of the world. To answer your question, yes, it's finding favors. In the lower rates are getting attention of taxpayers today. I think a few years back that was not the case because of the rates being high.
Initially, when safe harbor was thought of, the thinking was that the business should be concentrate more on business, and the ease of doing business was a carrot, but the higher rates were the stick.
Very good point. Very well said. Very well said. If you look at how safe harbors have evolved in other countries in the world, for example, you have safe harbors in Australia, you have safe harbors in the Philippines, in Singapore. One common theme that you see is that the countries there and the tax administrations there are very clear. There are some services or some sectors you want to promote. You want to support. You don't want them to get into a state of litigation, because then that will disturb their business. So in Australia, for example, you have safe harbors for non-core services, you know, business support services, right? So if an Australian company takes the support or provides support to group companies and, you know, some kind of business support services, so they say have a shared service center in Australia, they could agree on a cost plus 7.5%. That's a prescribed safe harbor rate in Australia. They could bill it out at cost plus 7.5%, no questions asked. Right? The objective of the Australian government there was to ensure that more shared service centers get set in Australia. And that was the thought process, that was the vision. Right? In India, I think they had that same vision, but the numbers that panned out were very high. And I think If I look at it from the tax administration standpoint, they were also in a bit of a dilemma, because they were fighting cases in courts where they were asserting that the markup should be 17% and 20% or even higher. Now they can't come with safe harbor which is in single digit. It puts them in a very bad light for all the past years. So I think they have to find a balance. I'm not advocating anybody, but I'm just saying that there was a dilemma at that point of time to say what rate should be. So therefore, We were in that situation. The good news is the rates have come down. Whether the rates will come down further, we will have to wait. But this is where we are.
Thank you. In OECD and UN both, is that a common rate approach should be taken. There is no point in hiking up the percentage margins. But if you would like to give a benefit to a particular type of industry or sector, you can reduce the rate of taxation for those particular things, keeping the percentage margins the same. So that could have evolved, and the thinking has been aired and voiced by many countries in OECD.
True. Thank you very much. So, to continue with where Ganesh left, as mentioned, the objective is always to identify the industries wherein your government want to promote. So, in line with that, in India, the safe harbor rules were broadly framed around IT, IT enabled services, KPO, contract R&D services, and if these were the broad areas wherein they framed safe harbor rules. In addition to this, they also frame if an Indian principal is giving loan to its wholly owned subsidiary, which is a non-resident, and giving a corporate guarantee, even these were covered under safe harbor at this point of time. As I mentioned earlier, the safe harbor rules were framed at two layers. One in 2013 and which were revised in 2017. In line with the OECD, they also included low value adding intra-group services, which is received by Indian entities from its group. It's also included under safe harbor. This is a very critical. I think many of you would have come across wherein naturally as a part of an MNC group, the Indian affiliates receive varied kind of services from its group affiliate, which we broadly call as a management fee. So this is one area of soft target for TPOs. You just prove why you need these services. Is there any benefit you are gaining from these services? And justifying this is always difficult, because many of the services were may not be in a tangible form. You call one of your CFO, you get an input. Is there any evidence is there? May not be. Now, all the time you cannot keep track of what kind of services you are getting. So, 2017, the low value added intra-group services also included. To coming into the safe harbor, from a two aspect becomes very important. Sorry. So, sure. So, in terms of two points we should be knowing. One is, who are the eligible assessees? The second aspect is, what were the eligible international transactions? This will be the primary area of focus in our discussion today. Eligible assessees. As I mentioned earlier, broadly the transactions which were covered under safe harbor in India are relating to IT, ITES, KPO, contract R&D. In these cases, what the principal point they say ki, these activities should not be, the Indian entity should not be taking insignificant risk. This should be morely a captive kind of situations wherein India providing services in a cost plus kind of scenarios. I'll come to what is insignificant risk, which is also defined under the Act very clearly. We will come to that. And the second category of transaction which is covered is corporate guarantee, which is provided by Indian entity to its wholly owned subsidiary. The other way is not included. If any of the MNC group is providing guarantee to an Indian sub, that is not an eligible SSC. So we should be careful of this point. And the another sector which is a primary focus area is on auto component. So auto component, auto ancillary sector is also included under safe harbor. The one more addition which I mentioned earlier is low value added intra-group services received. So be very careful on this. This IT, ITES, KPO we are talking about rendering of services by Indian entity. In case of low value added services, we are talking about receipt by an Indian entity. So this key differentiation which should be we have aware of. The other fact, I think when you see in the software, the term which comes is insignificant risk. I'll come to this specific point later in the point when we are discussing slightly on detail. So under safe harbor rules, when we talk about software development and contract R&D, definition were clearly prescribed. Do you want to make a guess? Do you able to differentiate what is a software development and contract R&D? Do you want to give any view on this? What I'll just pause a minute and the definition were put out there. You can just go through for some time. So the one of the practical challenges even being a consultant we face is how to differentiate these two activities. When a global entities are setting up their reserve for providing the captive services, they don't go by this definition. What is development and what is contract R&D? And if you look at the definitions, it is broadly we can differentiate the software development is more on if you are adding a functionality to the existing debugging activity, the basic coding you are taking care, these were covered under software development. But the research part, if you are coming up with an altogether new technology, if you read it, new theorems, algorithms, and coming up with a new operating system, designing, developing, deploying, and maintenance. So you can view it altogether something innovative you are coming up with, it will be covered under R&D, but there is a very thin line of differentiation. And when we go and meet the functional head with this definition, they say we are doing both. I can't put my activity into one bag. I am also doing some research, designing work also I am doing, I am also maintaining. So one of the challenge, at least the practical difficulty, is how to segregate this activity. Yes, when we go slightly into the deeper, we will be able to put into a bracket. So one of the pro cons when we, as a, I need to put it, this is one of the challenges generally we face.
Where from the legislature has taken this definition?
We don't have any idea.
Is there anything in foreign countries definition?
No.
So essentially the process of coming to safe harbor, of course there were a lot of representations from industries. There were drafts which were looked at, definitions, NASSCOM was involved. A lot of industry bodies gave their viewpoints on what constitutes activities. You can also look at NASSCOM's publications, in terms of what they define as software development. There are a lot of reports for the past years. I'm sure those would have been looked at to come to this kind of a definition. That was possible. Businesses evolve. That's the constant. Nobody continues to do software development for 10 years, right? So therefore, I think the life cycle of a business in India has also evolved. So some people maybe started in software development but have moved on to the more of R than the D. And if you look at research and development, there's more focus on R today than the D, possibly. So then they will obviously move out of software development into more of contract R&D. So to answer your question, there are certain publications, there were certain industry representations that were made at that point, which could have resulted into these definitions.
I would like to add one more. The antitrust judgments which have come abroad, they have also added to the learning curve and prompted many of the definitions which are given by OECD, UN, and which have been modified to suit local circumstances by various developed and developing countries.
Thank you. And if you see even when we go to the next slide, you will see the IT enabled were divided into a KPO and BPO. If you go and check with the NASSCOM, they say even we are not dividing the IT enabled into two categories, the way it is defined under our Income Tax Act. So as I mentioned, there is some area of gray, like how to put the activity into which basket. There will be some element of debate we can anticipate. But at present, if you look from a practical point of view, wherever the application has been filed, we never come across a situation wherein they question you are not falling into the category which you are saying you are. So yes, we can anticipate in the future, but at present, there is a subjectivity in these terms. If you look at the last point, it says in a contract R&D, upgradation of existing products where source code has been made available by the principal. If the source code is already available, naturally I will be upgrading it. If most of the activity can come under this cross. Even I am adding one feature, the officer can say that you are upgrading existing software product. So it's not the development you are doing R&D. So to that extent we should be aware of, but we need to live with the provision which were present as on date. The why it becomes very critical is the rate which were prescribed for software development start between 17 to 18. Whereas for a contract R&D situation, it is goes up to 24%. There is a significant variation in the rate which is expected under Safe Harbor. The software development, they categorized into two buckets. One, if you the revenue is less than 100 crore, the rate applicable is 17%. And if your value of international transaction is between 100 to 200, the rate is 18%. And one point I want to highlight here, if you see to opt for a safe harbor under software, there is an upper limit is there, which is 200 crore. Beyond if any taxpayer is higher than a 200, there is no option which is present at present. But if you go back to the earlier rules, there was an open-ended option was there. The rate were varying, but in a way, the rate were prescribed less than 500 crore, more than 500 crore. So in a way, even the large taxpayer were also covered in the erstwhile rules. But the present rules, they kept upper cap, so that they cover only the small and the medium enterprises under software development and R&D category. Here, this I want to discuss on one particular phase which we are talking about, insignificant risk. In IT, IT enabled contract R&D, wherever you see the provision, it says the Indian entity should be an insignificant risk bearing entity. So what does it mean by insignificant risk? Is anybody want to make a guess? What is insignificant risk they are referring? So they prescribe, just in the interest of time, they say key. The significant economic functions is undertaken by your overseas principal. What is significant economic function? They say strategic direction for a particular activity should be coming from your principal. And the core conceptualization and the designing is also happening at your global level. So you are just executing as per the direction. first principle they say is significant economic function should be happening by your foreign principle. The second guiding principle is the funding, capital, and if any asset. When I say asset, it also includes intangibles are made available by your group company. The third is the guiding principle to evaluate insignificant risk is, they say there should be a direct supervision. There should be a direct supervision from your group company of all the activity. When I say direct supervision, what does it mean?
They will direct, the principal will direct how you will move in this direction.
Your development, everything.
How you will develop. Correct. You don't go this way, you go that way.
So,
for every step they will interact.
Correct. Absolutely right, sir. So, on a direct supervision, they say, 2 points they highlight. One is, the person should, the overseas person should have a capability to supervise. The second thing is, he actually supervising. Just to put it, you know, if there is a software R&D activity is happening here, the key decision maker is sitting in India and the board is there, just an approving board is there, then this comes into a question. Is the person who is sitting in overseas, whether he has the capability to evaluate? So when we are doing as a part of functional interview for our evaluating the applicability, one of the point we want to stress, who are the persons looking after India operations? And what is their qualifications? What is their experience? This also comes into a very significant. One, they are saying, when you talk about direct supervision, he should have a capability. And can you prove that he has a capability, he is actually supervising? But generally, if you see, as Ganesh mentioned, due to the learning curve in India, after a few years of operations, Indian entities are becoming self-sufficient. They don't require really any guidance from the global. Because we come across a situation wherein the Indian employees are in the system from 10 to 12, 15 years and the global is a new guy sitting over there. So most of the decision making are taking place in India. So they stress upon this particular point. There should be a direct supervision is the third point they highlight. The fourth point is the economic ownership of intangibles. If the software development activities is undertaking, the ownership should be with the principal. This is the fourth condition. The fifth condition is risk. Significant risk should be with the overseas entity. So if these five conditions, one is significant economic functions, capital, intangibles, risk associated with the operations, and direction. If these five conditions are satisfied, only then this safe harbor provision will be applicable. You can opt for safe harbor. This is applicable for software development, IT enabled services, KPO, contract R&D. Because some other transactions were relating to guarantee loan, then this question will not arise.
So ideally, this safe harbor is applicable only for this costless method?
Yes, because the rate prescribed itself is framed in such a way that it is a costless as in subjective. So,
those lines they can use the same.
Correct. Absolutely right. So, again, the opting was always not driven by a cost plus entity. Cost plus is a pricing policy. As I mentioned, if being a learning curve, it gets to an Indian company, if Indian company is on its own doing this operation in a substance ground, then even you are operating in a cost plus model, the officer can question. He may say this is not applicable. So it's entirely dependent on these five principles. So generally the situation will be like that. There is always will be a supervision from group company and risk will be with the overseas intangibles. But these five principles we need to check whenever we are evaluating safe harbor.
So for these Indian MNCs, then these safe harbor rules won't be applicable.
Yes, absolutely.
They will not be able to enter these.
Yes. This is actually a provision of services to an overseas affiliate which is a non-resident. So other way it is not covered. The second important point in Indian MNCs, the size also will be a larger, so they want to evaluate those from an independence perspective.
But there may be some cases where, you know, SME to medium size type of firms.
Correct. And if you see, the objective is to cover the least complex transactions.
Okay.
So when you are talking about an entrepreneurial entity, you cannot say the operation will be least complex. Unless they look into what they are into, you cannot give a blanket option for a company to follow a particular methodology. So, please.
As discussed earlier, in case of SECs which does software development as well as contract R&D, so should we prepare a segmental and then apply the safe harbor of 17% and 24%, or what is the way out in cases where a company carries on both activities?
That should be the way out. You are absolutely right. You may need to split your financials, identifying your activity, what portion of the activity which is covered under contract R&D and what portion is the software development. But as I mentioned, if the answer to this question would have been so simple, it is very simple, because splitting financial is not a difficult task. The problem comes when you are not sure where my activity will fit into. Because these terms, whatever explained provided, were subjective. I can interpret that language in one way, the other person can interpret in a different way. Because there is not much judicial precedence is there, what is the meaning of that definition. So it will take some time, but broadly, once you look at the operation, you can, your major portion of the activity will fit into a particular category. The next set of activities, ITES and KPO. The Act were clearly prescribed the definition for both the set of activity. To put it, how they differentiated the activity, they say, in a KPO scenario, you are applying some knowledge, analytical skills and technical skills, whereas in an ITES category, it was more straightforward activity without significant application of knowledge, technical skills you can perform. Just to read out back office operation, call center, data processing, payroll remote. These were categorized under IT enabled, and the few business analytics, financial analytics, human resource, these were categorized under knowledge process outsourcing activity. In terms of rate applicability, ITES is identical to a software scenario wherein 17% and 18% based on a turnover criteria it is applicable. In a KPO, the approach adopted is slightly different. So when we say about human resource services, they categorize under KPO. To how significantly it is adding value, how complex is the activity, how much is the value addition it is happening. They have taken employee cost ratio as a basis. They are saying, when I look at your employee cost, if your employee cost is taking care of significant portion of your cost,
probably you are doing high value added activity. If your employee cost vis-a-vis your total cost is lower, probably you are doing a less complex or routine activity. So if you see the categorization is depend on three buckets. One is your employee cost is above 60%, then the 24% applicable, then 40 to 60%, it's 21%, and below 40%, it is 18%. So probably this is the right approach, what we can say. Somebody can question, you are saying human resource services are KPO, but you look at the people who are doing human resource or routine graduates, they are not, we are not required high skilled employees for performing this human resource activity. So the best way option is you can check what is the employee cost to total cost ratio, which is less than 40, you will be applicable 18%, which were closer to a 90-year number. So here the one of the points we should be aware of is employee cost is clearly defined under the Act. It covers broadly, to put it, all the cost which is associated with employees, staff welfare, training, PF, your termination expenditure, everything is covered under employee cost while calculating this ratio. Yes. So I can say even the staff welfare expenditure is also covered. The one point I want to highlight here is, you know, if you see the routine IT, IT enabled, some portion of the activities our Indian subsidiaries are outsourcing to a third party vendors. So there is an implied rule is covered under this rule. They say if you are outsourcing some portion of the activity to a third party vendor, if you can identify employee cost very clearly, you include it. If you are not able to identify, the rule says assume 80% of your outsourcing expenditure as an employee cost for calculating this ratio. Very unique provision, but this is very clearly stipulated.
Yes, this employee cost, whatever you are mentioning, that is the employee cost the Indian entity or the group entity? Because say for example, in one of the cases, the Indian subsidiary, the employees of the Indian subsidiary have got the ESOP from the parent entity. So whatever the ESOP expenses that will be used in the parent entity, it's not it will not be there in the Indian entity. So maybe, I mean, it's not the cost for the Indian entity, but it's the cost for the employee cost for the group entity.
In a very good point, in 2017, I'll come to that in a slightly later point of time. While defining operating margin, operating revenue and operating expenditure, there is a clear provision is there on ESOP cost, how we need to treat. At that time, I will take this.
So, and in case of many KPO companies, it happens that they take the services of external consultants in many cases. So, will that also be included as an employee cost, because majority of the portion of the work is also done by taking the help of these consultants who work for this
people. So even if you are taking an employee on a contract basis, that is also getting included under employee cost. So if you see the definition, they gone ahead, forget about only your contract and permanent employee. If you are outsourcing some portion of the activity to a third party vendor, he may not be having a direct, I am giving you this many employees, you pay me. This is my project, you do this project, and the Indian sub need to pay this much amount. They are saying 80% of that cost, you assume it as an employee cost. So yes, it's included. Again, when you say consultant, what they are doing?
Correct.
So, you know, when they are saying outsourcing employee also, you need to include. And you can go through, it is clearly well defined definition is there under rules. So, on a ITES and KPA, broadly the activity and the critical point only on employee cost, which we should be aware of. The next is corporate guarantee. Corporate guarantee, I want to stress upon, the corporate guarantee is provided by Indian entity to wholly owned subsidiary of its group. Very critical, it should be an explicit guarantee. If it is an implicit, just Indian entity is giving us some comfort letter to bank, it will not be covered. It should be an explicit guarantee provided to wholly owned subsidiary. Only when the safe harbor rules will be applicable. And it's a non-resident, it's very clear that the more the TP provisions will come when one of the party is a non-resident, so it's understood. If your wholly owned subsidiary should be a non-resident entity.
Why the safe harbor rules is not pointing, I mean, is not prescribing any rates in a reverse way where the Indian entity has received loan from the
That should be the ideal scenario wherein a significant portion of cases would have been covered, but they want to keep those outside the purview of safe harbor.
But it's not the, it's not the reverse way which, that's what it is, when investment flows in to India, that's the major portion, I think. Through loan and all it will come. So there is a chance that they can pump in huge amount out of India through
this. See, one of the criteria you believe, prescribing a safe harbor rate for a transaction like guarantee and loan is a very complicated exercise. There were so many parameters comes into picture. If you see the rate prescribed at present, they are not even taking tenure into consideration. So if you prescribe a rate without dwelling into the final aspect of a contract, it may create a broader exposure to the tax administration. Probably that may be the reason they don't want to include the other way around. Then again, the thing capitalization issues, there are many picture comes into picture when they talk about funding from overseas entity to India. So probably that may be the reason they want to keep it outside. The rate which is prescribed is 1% of the room granted for a guarantee. Moving on to intercompany loans. Here also the provision is broadly identical to guarantee scenario where they say ki the loan should be granted to wholly owned subsidiary. This is the one critical point we should be aware. The second, if the loan granted is by a banking, financial institutions or any financial institution which is into a lending and borrowing activity, it will not be covered. They want to keep it because their major operations will be on borrowing and lending. So that is kept out of purview of safe harbor. The third critical aspect they say, there should be a fixed term of repayment. If there is a credit line without any fixed term, that will not be covered under intragroup loan under safe harbor. These were the critical terms we should be aware of, especially in relating to intragroup advances. One is wholly owned subsidiary. The second one is on banking and financial institutions, this will not be covered. Third one, there should be a fixed repayment term. The rate prescribed, if you look into the rate prescribed, it is broadly the categorization is based on INR denominated funds vis-a-vis foreign denominated funds. They say if it is a INR denominated funds, the rate is linked to marginal cost of SBI lending rate, whereas in case of foreign denominated rate, the rate is linked to LIBOR rate of a respective currency. This is a very realistic approach adopted in the revised rules. One of the challenges which is faced in our older rules is there were no rate which is linked to a LIBOR kind of situation. Even the loan was granted in a foreign currency, the safe harbor rate prescribed SBI base rate linked rates. It was in some cases become practically impossible to implement. So these were very, the other aspect, if you see the rate prescribed, says marginal cost of lending rate plus a spread of 175 to 625 basis point. This differential rate is based on a credit rating of the borrower, and the credit rating is linked to CRISIL credit rating. Do you find any odd, or you believe, is there anything odd is prescribed here? Do you view, is there any practicality, practical implementation, how is it possible?
Why only CRISIL?
No, this has been prescribed. See, the larger aspect you see, CRISIL is an Indian credit rating agency. The borrower we are talking about are overseas borrowers. And we are saying that this is broadly we want to cover the players who are medium scale. And under the rules we are asking them to get it credit rated from CRISIL. It itself is a very costly affair. And is the Indian regulatory rating to rating agency provides option for rating an overseas entity. There is a practical difficulty there also. Right. So these were the final aspect. Maybe there is a third refinement of this if they may look into this aspect. There is some amount of impossibility also involved here. To overcome this, there is one more category they prescribe. In addition to this CRISIL linked, there is one, if you see the in advance of intra-group loan, fifth category they are saying, 422 basis point. They are saying, if there is no credit rating is there, 422 basis point will be applied. The one rider they are saying here, your total borrowings cannot cross 100 crore. 100 crore from all the associated group. If you see the first four bracket, there is no upper limit. But in the fourth category where they think there is no credit rating is required, two points I want to highlight. Indian entity advancing should not cross 100 crore. 100 crore in total, if it has a 5 subsidiaries, the total lending should not cross 100 crore. Only then safe harbor is applicable. The same goes with foreign currency, wherein the rate is linked to a LIBOR of a respective currency, and which date rate you need to take also very clearly prescribed, April 1st for INR, denominated on 30th September for foreign currency. So these were the broad points we should be aware of. So the other point which comes into a loan situation is, I obtained a loan 3 years back.
Excuse me, so how do you calculate?
See, this whatever on 1st April for a relevant particular year, there will be an SBI marginal rate will be there. Yes. So you need to add 175 basis point, 1.75% to that rate. Then you calculate. So one of the point here we need to aware, suppose I obtained the loan 3 years back. Can I go for it, or it should be a fresh loan? No, I want to say, to cover the thing under safe harbor, is it should be a fresh loan I am obtained during the relevant year, or the loan which is I obtained 3 years back, I am paying interest this year also, can I get it covered under safe harbor? So, if you look at the regulation, there is no if you look at the regulations, there is no clear direction on this particular point. But we can take a view, because as it is not clearly excluded, we can take a view ki even if it is a loan obtained in another year, old year, as I am paying interest this particular year, it is can be get covered. The third point I want to highlight here is, okay, I'll take a credit rating from a CRISIL. Do I need to take credit rating each year? Because rating will not be a constant thing. This is also, there is no direction within the regulations. But based on a practicality, we can take a view ki, as I've already taken a rating for a particular area, same should be applied.
Not apply for years to come.
Absolutely, but there is no clear, but taking a credit rating year on year basis itself will take away the benefit of safe harbor.
Yeah, I think the other thing to also bear in mind is such lending transactions are for fixed tenure. And you know, when you have such a financial transaction, the time you enter into such a transaction, you determine the credit rating. You determine, you know the period of the loan, and therefore you determine the interest rate. Now every year you cannot renegotiate it, because the two parties will not be, they would have determined the interest rate based on various assumptions. So the expectation cannot be that you should do a credit rating every year. You will do it at the time you enter into the transaction, and that will hold good for the period of time.
As I mentioned earlier, in this intra-group loan, in any loan situation, tenure is a very basic part of entire arrangement. This has been kept out of, there is nothing linked to tenure. Maybe this is one of the aspects they don't wanted to include the loans wherein Indian subs are getting from these group companies. Yes, yes. This is even the rules clearly provides, but there is a procedure. You need to do it in advance when filing a return. You need to make a very clear statement ki, I want to opt out of this scheme this for this particular year. Yes, that option is always.
Proper reasoning or
that? No, you can opt out. But probably once you opt out, during the scrutiny, the first question will come, why you are opting out? Is there any new activity you started doing? Is there any change in your functional profile? So obviously these kind of questions will come up.
But with the justification saying that my margins are less than whatever of this kind of that's fine, right?
Correct. You can opt out, but from a practical point of time, you think once you 1 year adopted, you agreed your plan, ki, I want to go with that margin. Generally, you will not change. You would have had a well thought out plan. Yes, going forward, I want to have a safe harbor option to mitigate my litigation. So it will be a long term plan. Yes, the situation can change if some other group acquired globally. They may have their own differential policies. They may opt out, but option is always there.
Basically, the safe harbor rules, they are akin to that presumptive taxation under the Indian tax laws.
Yep.
And if an assessee feels that the presumptive taxation will be a higher burden, he can always opt out of that and go for a lesser burden.
If an entity is having two or three types of transaction, can they choose piecemeal, like I'll apply same number to one?
Yes.
And not to the other?
Yes, you can do that. That option is there. Because we come across many cases wherein the client opted for a safe harbor relating to shared services, which is software, but they had a management fee. They felt ki, even for me demonstrating, because there is a minimal level of documentation is required if you are opting for a management fee. So they said we are not prepared, so we want to go with only the provision of services, so you can do that.
And this threshold of this 400 crores and 100 crores, whether both have to be satisfied, or for example, an enterprise has, let's say, more than 200 crores turnover.
Which transaction you are referring? See, the 200 crore stops with ITES contract R&D. In loan, it's this transaction wise. There is no. Yes. Those were provision of services by an Indian entity. These were lending of loan and guarantee. Yes. 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 Absolutely. The only rider they placed is if it is not a credit rating is not done. So total loan, they are not taking it to revenue. Total loan provided by Indian entity should not cost 100 crore. This pharma, in the interest of time, the rate prescribed is around 12 and 8.5. They are saying core auto component, non-core auto component, broad categorization is there. For a core, the rate prescribed is 12%. For non-core, it is 8.5%. The only point I want to highlight here is manufacturing and export. If you are manufacturing export into your group affiliate, that transaction is covered under safe harbor. If I am having, so I am purchasing raw material from group company, I am doing a manufacturing here, that is not covered. The transaction which is covered is purchase and export. So that one point I want to highlight at this point of time. Low value added intra-group services. I think this would be a slightly area which we face, come across in most of the M&E clients. Because management fee, generally you come across as a cost, and I can say 10 out of 10 cases, if the case is get for DP scrutiny, there is a management fee payment, it is get disapproved. Despite in many cases we will file the evidences, but the ultimate outcome they say it is disallowed. Even the officer sometime in our hearing they say, I completely agree with you, in your case you have a strength, but as a rule across group we decided ki, if the management fee is there, we will disallow. In an informal way they will give this explanation. I totally appreciate your case, but as a rule, we want to disallow management fee, you don't want to accept. Anyway, you have a strong case, go to ITAT, you will get a favorable ruling.
So, the disallowance,
how does it work? Okay, so what if there is a management fee is there, the TPO say, ki you made, I am not able to convince with your need and benefit you are getting from this payment, so I will treat the ALP as zero. If you are paying 10 crores to a group company, as per me, the value is zero. So I will adjust that entire 10 crore as TP adjustment. So this being a slightly relevant subject, I just want to put here, it may be interested for our us also. The broad, it says, these activities should be a support activity and it should not be a core function of that M&E group. The objective of bringing this safe harbor is low value added activities. They don't want to cover the key activities under safe harbor. The second one what they are referring is it should be a non-core activity. The third point, there should not be any involvement of intangibles in this activity. If you are doing any intangible activity using intangibles, or your activity are resulting into an intangible, this will not be covered under this. And shareholder duplicate. Shareholder generally, what happens being a subsidiary company in India, there will be function performed by your group company as a shareholder of yourself. So those will not be covered under this categorization. They say if this for low value added activity, if you are paying a cost plus markup which is 5% or more, we are fine with the management fee. And the total quantum they describe is 10 crore. As long as management fee is less than 10 crore, you are not charging markup 5 and less, then they will accept this transaction. Where is the opportunity for us as a professional? They prescribe, see, there is a certification required from an accountant on a cost pooling methodology and how the allocation has been made. Is the allocation key are reasonable? Are the shareholder cost and duplicate cost were excluded by the overseas entity? There is a certification required. This is a good point. The flip side is definition of accountant. I don't know why this definition is there, but I just want to highlight. They say if you are operating as a partnership firm, you should be operating in a more than one country.
More than one country?
Yes. And your annual receipt should be during the preceding year 10 crore. Yes. So, if you are operating as a firm, if you are individually you are practicing, they say your annual receipt should be 1 crore during the preceding year. The second, you should be having at least 10 years of professional experience. Only in this situation, it will be considered as an accountant for this rule. So their objective probably, the intention may be to whoever is getting a certification, it is some reputation is there so that he is not giving away the certification. But it has a flip side also. You can always argue this, why is this required? You need to treat all the professional in a same parity. But we need to
one has to have a foreign office also.
That is if you are operating as a partnership firm. If you are practicing as an individual, your annual receipt they are saying should be 1 crore during the preceding year and 10 years of professional experience.
So medium size firm.
Correct. Safe harbors are also applicable for few of the specified domestic transactions, which is broadly applicable to government companies which were involved in power transmission, wheeling and all. I think in the interest of time, I don't want to dwell into much because being in a TP, I never practically come across these situations. One is on a government company which were involved in power transmission supply. The second one is cooperative societies which is in milk and milk related product. If they are dealing with the member firm, those there is some safe harbor has been prescribed, not of much relevance. Here, I just want to spend some time on definition of operating expenditure. It's very clearly laid out while calculating operating expenses for margin computation, interest, pre-operating costs, loss arising from foreign currencies, extraordinary expenditure. Broadly they are saying any cost which is not related to your regular operation should be kept out of operating cost while calculating the margin. The other interesting latest update they mentioned, I just want to highlight on a ESOP cost. In an ESOP cost they are saying if your parent company is paying any ESOP to the employee of your Indian subsidiary, that cost to be included. The second they are saying, any reimbursement or recovery of expenditure which you are going to your group company, while calculating margin for safe harbor, include that. One practical challenge you face, recovery of expenditure, sometime for an administrative convenience, you make a payment. If overseas fellow is coming here, his food cost or whatever you
overseas fellow will come, they will stay in a hotel and they will travel and all that.
Correct.
So this cost are getting.
So sometime what happens if you see practically in your P&L in a regular financials, it will not even appear. It will be routed through balance sheet. But they are saying you please include. This is the rule they prescribe for safe harbor. The intention is simple, because sometimes what happened in a cost plus kind of scenario, the entity try to keep some cost out of purview of that cost plus margin. They say this is nothing to do with my operations, this is just a recovery. So with to avoid those kind of situations, they said you please include those as a form of cost base. That is a significant point we should be aware of.
Just I have one question. Is there any possibility that the officer
I close this so that I think I have a limited time. I just try to close this procedural box, right? And then we can take the questions. So broadly, these were the transactions were covered. What is the procedure? Procedure is fairly simple. I need to file a form which is called 3CFA along with the tax return. While filing my tax return, I need to file a form which is a specific safe harbor form. Which are the years I want to cover under safe harbor? And what is the nature of my activity? What is the transaction I am covering? I need to make a form. As if you recollect, one of the benefit I said of safe harbor is the timeline. In a regular scenario, the cases run for 10 years. Here you get a certainty within a period of max 6 to 7 months. The stringent timelines are prescribed. You file a form within 2 months from the end of the month when this form has filed, assessing officer need to act. He need to accept. Or within 2 months from end of the month when the application filed, he can refer it to a transfer pricing officer saying ki there is a this kind of application came, you just check whether he is an eligible assessee, whether it is an eligible transaction, you evaluate. Then the TPO has only 2 months, he need to respond. From end of the month he received a reference from a AO. Whether is acceptable or not. If not, he need to communicate to a taxpayer and to the assessing officer saying ki this is not qualified. If the taxpayer has any dispute with the ruling given by a TPO, within 15 days, he need to make an application with the commissioner. Commissioner under whom the TPO comes. The commissioner again has a 2 months time. He need to give a ruling whether whatever concluded by the TPO is correct, or he will give a reversal opinion saying you can opt for a safe harbor. So if you see the procedure really, it is just 6 months, you will be clear whether I am qualified for safe harbor or not. If at any stage any of the officer will not act, it is assumed that your application is valid. There is no option available for a department to question once this time has lapsed. I think broadly on a procedural point, I want to cover this. If you all have any specific questions, I will be happy to address. See, you file in, suppose you are filing your return in November. Along with that return, you will file an application. So, assessing officer within 2 months, before January, he has an option to accept it or refer it to the TPO. So, before January end, he need to refer it to the TPO. If he is not convinced, he has some doubts. So, then the TPO has 2 months time from the end of the month when he received the application. So, before March, TPO need to accept and give the acceptance to the AO along with taxpayer, or he need to reject. So, then obviously he need to take action before March. Then, the taxpayer has a time of 15 days. So March, April 15th. Before April 15th, he need to decide whether if the TPO rejected it. Within 50 days, he need to make an application with the commissioner. Commissioner under whom the relevant TPO comes. So then, that particular commissioner has 2 months from the time of the application filed. Application is filed in April. So April 30, end of month. So he has 2 months. It will mean June. By June, he need to give his ruling. So it gets completed.
So all these things are relating to us, but the eligibility.
Yes. So it is the same way. It is linked to when you are filing your return.
So if this is the case, then you don't have to file CCEB.
You will file CCEB before the due date for filing tax return. So.
So all three should go hand in hand. CCEB, CCEFA, and
correct. This is one of the, at least we also made a representation. When you are opting for a safe harbor, what is the necessity for me to doing 3CEP or even keeping the documentation? But as the law stands today, we need to comply with...
They don't know whether they will approve it or not. No?
Correct. Even, yes, agree, so first year agree. Even in the future years, because when you are opting, you can opt for 3 years. At present, whatever the safe harbor is there, which is for financial year 16, 17, 17, 18, 18, 19. 3 years you can opt. But the, as per the law stands today, even for the next 2 years, it is getting covered under your safe harbor. You need to file a Form 3 CEP during those years and maintain a TPO documentation. And one of the, even as a part of when the case comes up, the AO need to look into that. Is my cost base is correctly computed? Is the 70% whatever? That he'll look into anyway. I think any other questions you have? Otherwise, broadly, I want to complete safe harbor. Sorry, I'll just take maybe 2-3 minutes. Once you opt for a safe harbor, I think you would have learned in your previous session about capacity adjustment, working capital adjustment. There will be no adjustment, anything will be allowed. 17 in 17. There is no adjustment will be allowed. The second point, the proviso of less or minus 3%, which you would have learned in your earlier session, not applicable. That is one point I want to highlight. Then it says if you are the overseas associated enterprises is notified under 94A. I think few of the like Cyprus and all notified under 94A, wherein India doesn't have a free tax information sharing or they are not operating. Those entity, if you have a transaction, will not be covered under safe harbor. Transaction. If you have a transaction with the entity which is located in Cyprus, at present only Cyprus is notified. Is it correct?
So any transaction in notified jurisdictions will not comply with the purview of safe harbor.
And in addition to 94A, they say ki if the jurisdiction is no tax or a low tax jurisdiction, then also will not be covered. They say. What is low tax? They say if the maximum rate of income tax is less than 50, that will be categorized as a low tax jurisdiction. So the transaction with those jurisdictions also will not be covered. I think that's it.
One question. If the safe harbor application is rejected, so we have the financial year is over, so we must be based on the safe harbor, we must have
calculated all the transaction must have happened.
Right.
And if it is rejected, so then what is the implication?
Our
sale price can be lesser than the safe harbor.
The lesser than safe harbor from the point of view of taxpayer.
Yeah,
but if you see the regular litigation, the rate was described whether TPOs are upward of 20%. So we will go into a regular litigation approach.
So it will be regularly taken up and it will go through the assessment process. Depending on the materiality of transactions, complexity, the taxpayer may be audited, may not be audited by the transferring officer. So essentially, if it's rejected, it may be rejected because you don't fall under the category that's prescribed, but then you would be prepared that you may be audited in the future. That's how it is. Thanks, Deepak, for this wonderful presentation. We will take a break right now, a tea break, and we'll probably resume with the next discussion on advanced pricing agreements. I would request all of you to have your questions. I know that time is short, we couldn't address many questions, but please keep your questions. We will take it up in the next session.